Beloved community, grace and peace to you from the one in whom we live and move and have our being. For our hearts are restless until they find their rest in God. Whether you are joining us from the comfort of your home or here in the sanctuary, we welcome you to worship on this All Saints Sunday as we continue our theme, Rooted in Love. I invite you to show up today just as you are, with your questions or certainties, with joy or in grief, weary or grateful. There are many ways to get rooted in love in this service through music and prayer, shared testimony and contemplative listening. So attune to the Spirit and move as you feel moved. Bring the fullness of who you are to this hour of worship, for wide is God's welcome. For those of you who don't know me, I am Reverend Amanda, the senior minister here at First Church. I just had to see how that sounds. Last Sunday was such a joy. Friends, we remain in phase three of our regathering plan, and every Sunday we welcome up to 25 people in the sanctuary while others join us by Zoom for hybrid worship. It is a great joy to see the faces of old friends in the sanctuary. We're grateful to see Mari and Diana today. We're grateful to see John and Carolyn Marsh. I know Anissa and Bea are here. So what a lovely, joyful gathering we are this morning. If you are joining us from home, please do take a moment to place a photograph of a departed one on your table with a votive candle in preparation for our prayer of remembrance later in the service. And as a reminder to those in the sanctuary, please do remain masked, observe distancing, and we invite you to hum rather than sing our hymns. Helping us with technology, Alex Chang will serve as our Zoom moderator, Tom Sowers as our sound designer, and Tom is celebrating a birthday today. So happy birthday, Tom. We're so grateful to have you here. And Dennis Turner is our guest musician today. Thank you to all of them and to Reverend Sam for making today's service possible. Following worship, please join us for fellowship either through our Zoom coffee hour or by greeting others here in the sanctuary. And now let us cross the threshold into worship. Please rise in body or in spirit for our opening hymn, For All the Saints.
Thank you. We gather today on the eve of All Saints' Day, Halloween, the eve of All Hallows' Day. This is the time of year which ancient peoples in the Northern Hemisphere treated as the end of the old year. The harvest was in, the days were getting shorter and colder, and the light was disappearing. They viewed this to be a liminal time, so that a liminal time when the barriers between the physical and the spiritual world thinned, so that the dead might return. This was not good news. It was frightening, because it was believed that the dead were resentful about their diminishment, and this could make them mean. So people adopted practices to protect themselves from the roaming dead, such as erecting frightening decorations and wearing disguises. Arriving Christianity denied that the dead came back in any ghoulish way, but vestiges of ancient beliefs persist in contemporary Halloween customs, though now reduced to foolery, commercial exploitation, and amusements for children. Christians begin the year a month later at the beginning of Advent, but observe the ancient turn towards the dead through All Saints' Day. In the past, this was a day when people would pray to saints, those already with God, to intervene with God on their behalf. Joined to that was All Souls' Day, in which the living prayed for those not yet with God, but languishing in purgatory. The Reformation suppressed these practices, emphasizing every person's relationship to God. So what's the meaning of All Saints' Day for us today? Of course, it is good to reflect on the examples of recognized saints whose lives illuminate the Christian life for us, the Dorothy Days and the Pauli Murrays, as well as the shining examples that we have known here at First Church. There are so many. Today, I'll only mention one, Richard Griffiths. For me, All Saints' Day primarily is a time to renew lovingly my relationships with family and friends who have died. Their lives may have ended, but our relationship continues and evolves. Their importance in my life endures. Sometimes I speak with them in prayerful imagination. My parents both died long ago, but I continue to strive to put in perspective the love and care they gave me and the hurt and the guilt that's entwined. I look for forgiveness in all directions. My beloved sister Kathy died in 2017, but I continue to ask her for advice and try to embrace her by loving her sons. Hardly a day goes by when Karen and I don't share a memory of her mother, who died at the beginning of the COVID. There is grief in all this, but also reassurance and inspiration. Perhaps we can still spiritually embrace this liminal time of the year. All Saints' Day reminds us that the passing of those we love leaves us not just with sadness, but with the possibility to continue our relationships with them in a new way, one that honors their memory and can enrich our own lives now. So let us join together and worship the God who exists at all times.
When we think about the All Saints, here's just one thing. We think about how their spirit is with us, how they are cheering us on, wanting us to be close with God. I want to show you something. Unsurprisingly, I have a baseball ball. And this baseball is 1926, and it's written by all of the 1926 Columbia University Lions. And it's written to Sam. And this is my namesake. I'm named after Sam Lambeth. And I never met Sam. He passed. He's my grandfather. He passed before I was born. And for my 46 years, he has been a part of my spirit, cheering me on, trying to help me be the person God wants me to be. And for children, theaters, and why, one of the most important things that we can do for All Saints Day is ask questions. Ask questions about those people that meant a lot to your mom, meant a lot to your dad, and hear stories. I love hearing stories about my grandfather. This is what I know about. He sold advertising for the New York Times. He was a rotten golfer, and he loved his girls more than anything. And he also loved baseball. And by listening to stories, that's a really special way for them to stay really close in our heart when we think about those people that are going home to God. So today I invite all of us to ask questions, to tell stories, to learn, to refresh these memories of people that have nurtured us, have guided us, have inspired us, and have reminded us that we are loved so, so much, and that people believe in us so, so much. Okay? Well, thank you all very much, and thank you for letting me share my story about my grandfather. Later today, we're going to see a video of all these wonderful saints that shared and guided and inspired everyone. So let us stand up and say a few little loving God, we thank you for our sins.
We thank you for our sins.
May their stories and spirit continue to inspire our guides.
May their stories and spirit continue to inspire our guides.
And remind us that we are loved.
And remind us that we are loved.
As most people know, we've been balancing our time between Vermont and D.C. over the last couple of years. But actually, we're both pretty much retired, and we're really anticipating spending most of our time up in Vermont going forward. So we're members of a church up there, West Newbury Congregational Church, UCC. My grandfather was a minister there in the 60s, so we have deep roots up there as well. And we've really found over the past year or so that we can't really fully participate here as members at First Church, especially, and you know, as COVID ebbs and we resume in-person worship. But even with that, it's hard to be part of two communities. And since we're actually up in Vermont now, probably a majority of time as we're balancing our time, we've decided that we should probably step back from our membership here and move into a friends status. We still have deep ties to this congregation, but it's really hard to sort of be halfway present, and I feel like we shortchange our relationships here when we try to do that. It's a bittersweet sort of day for us. We're excited about you know, being up there in a beautiful place that we love with, you know, people, a community that we feel part of. But it is wrenching to step away from First Church. We owe this church more than we can say. I'm going to try to read this list of important parts of our time here without getting too emotional. But our children were baptized here and raised here. We're in innumerable Christmas pageants here, which we treasure. This church memorialized my father 4 years ago. It was his home and a really incredibly important home for him. This church prepared me for my brother coming out in the early 90s, which is something I think the closest to divine providence that's ever happened in my life. And we've been members here for 32 years, since 1989 we came. I've sung in the choir for all 32 of those years, and I think I might be the longest serving choir member at this point. It's been a lot of Easter services, a lot of Advents, you know, a lot of really wonderful musical experiences. So, you know, we leave wonderful friends, and I guess thinking about this day as a day of the All Saints Day, I was looking through that list of folks that people had memorialized and thinking of all those names and people that I've known and their contributions to my life over those years. You know, I just could go on a huge list. I don't know, I think about people like the Wilbers, and I've never been in the presence of such a voice in person as Howie Wilbur. He was amazing and an amazing person. So he and all kinds of people, I could just list on and on, and they're just memories they'll be indelible. So, do you want to say something, Carolyn?
Okay. No, it's just been a pleasure serving with all of you. And, you know, we'll come back for sure for visiting. But, yeah, and I enjoyed teaching all the Sunday school and all the Christmas pageants. And as John Mack always said, the miracle happened when it all came together for those Christmas pageants, which it did. But yeah, so it's hard for us, but feels like the right thing to do at this point. But you guys are all welcome to come visit us in Vermont. So we would love that too. So, all right. Thanks. Yeah.
So the full part, let's thank all the John and Carolyn for all the gifts that they have blessed with us and. And the good news is, when they're not in Vermont, they'll be back with us. So they'll still be our friends, they'll still be with us, and that really is, thank you for sharing that message. The Spirit is here, so now let us share the peace of Christ with one another. May the peace of Christ be with you.
Peace, everyone. Peace be with everybody.
Good morning.
Good morning. Marshes.
Peace to the Marshes.
Peace, everyone.
Peace. Hey,
Robert.
Good morning.
One more thing.
Peace, everybody.
Y'all,
thank you.
Xavier.
Oh, look at the Halloween.
Peace. Hi to all the kids and the animals.
Yes. Happy Halloween.
Hi, Barbara.
Hi, Barbara.
Peace.
tested it, so okay. Yeah. What's that? Yeah. Okay. All right. While the party could never end, the service has got to continue. Peace. The love felt here and the love felt on Zoom is palpable, and we are so blessed and grateful for that. And now I invite us all to return to our place where our heart and our mind can be centered as we listen to Dennis. Thank you.
read today's scripture with the several challenging names. So Amanda told me to just read them with conviction and nobody will know. So that's what I intend to do, whether I mispronounce them or not. The scripture reading is from Ruth 1, 1 through 18. In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem in Judah went to live in the country of Moab. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife was Naomi, and the name of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephrathites from Bethlehem in Judah. They went into the country of Moab and remained there. But Elimelech died, and Naomi was left with her two sons. They took two Moabite wives. The name of one was Orpah, and the name of the other was Ruth. When they had lived there about 10 years, both Mahlon and Chilion also died, so that the woman was left without her two sons and her husband. Then she started to return with her daughters-in-laws from the country of Moab, for she had heard that the Lord had considered God's people and given them food. So she set out from the place where she had been living, she and her two daughters-in-law, and they went on their way to go back to the land of Judah. But Naomi said to her daughters-in-law, "Go back, each of you, to your mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant that you may find security, each of you, in the house of your husband." Then she kissed them, and they wept aloud. They said to her, "No, we will return with you to your people." But Naomi said, "Turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Do I still have sons in my womb that they may become your husbands? Turn back, my daughters. Go your way, for I'm too old to have a husband. Even if I should have a husband tonight and bear sons, would you wait until they were grown? Would you refrain from marrying? No, my daughters, it has been far more bitter for me than for you, because the hand of the Lord has turned against me." Then they wept aloud again. Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her. So she said, "See, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. Return after her." But Ruth said, "Do not press me to leave you or to turn back from following you. Where you go, I will go. Where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die. There I will be buried. May the Lord do thus and so to me, and more as well, if even death parts me from you."
Will you pray with me? Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Speak through the veil, that your truth might be our bread and your hope our sustenance. Amen. It may be a vocational hazard of clergy to lean into the impending nature of death and dying. Pastors practice talking about death in hospitals and living rooms, from the pulpit and in private prayer. Confess you're a pastor on a plane or at a party, and it can lead to questions about life after death, burial versus cremation, even stories of witnessing a loved one's transition. I have counseled families staring down death, prayed over bodies in the act of dying, and stood with families in the morgue as they sang excruciating farewells to beloved bodies, I have eulogized the saints of the church and our lives. I have coached parents on how to speak to their children about death. This is holy work. And Reverend Sam and I do it with gratitude, deeply mindful of the privilege of being invited into these intimate moments of family life. This is part of our calling, to bless and accompany souls through the shocking rigors of both birthing new life and releasing it back to God. It is our holy work to remind us all, death is part of the cycle of life. It comes for each one of us. And the gospel promises that the new life of resurrection rides in on the heels of death. All Saints Sunday is countercultural in our death-denying society. Halloween and All Saints Day originate from the same Celtic festival. Samhain marked a liminal time in the wheel of the year when the souls of the dead were thought to revisit their homes, not unlike Dia de los Muertos. It is a holy day when we invite the voices of the saints, living and dead, to whisper through the thinning veil between this world and the next. It is a time when we carry the complexity of their stories, reminded of the fragility of human living, of the saint and sinner in each of us. This time of year quiets me with wonder as formations of wild geese take flight against pale, crisp skies, as fiery tree limbs bow in the wind. In the dusk of the morning, the first rays of sun catch a dew-laced spider web, and the whole world seems dusted with magic. It is a good time to remember our dead, a good season to take seriously our own death, and in so doing, to reinvigorate our lives. Today's story from the book of Ruth is thrust forward by the power of death. It begins, in the days when judges ruled, there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem went with his family to live in the country of Moab. According to Glenn Jordan, the Hebrew word translated here as famine is ra'av, which signifies both the lack of food and the absence of morals, even kindness. In other words, a famine in the land devastated not only crops, but the common laws of human morality. When your child is starving, laws tend to break down. In times of famine, it was thought that respectable leaders should remain in their communities to serve and model right ways to live. In the case of Elimelech, who was once a man whose character preceded him, he instead took refuge in a foreign land. This was not simply an act of survival, but one of betrayal, because the land to which he fled was none other than Moab, that of a despised people whose refusal to help Israel in their time of need was never to be forgotten or forgiven. As Jordan notes, the storyteller knows that the old stereotypes of mean, tight-fisted Moabites could be relied on to anticipate a certain unfolding of the story, for only a fool would flee to Moab during great hunger. Elimelech doubled down on foolishness, settling there and blessing his sons' marriages to Moabite women. It was not simply the land of Moab or its people that were tarnished in the eyes of Israel, but their women, those Moabite women. Loose, it was said, Jezebelian, prone to hook their men with promiscuity and lead them directly into the temples of their foreign gods, or so the trope said. This complex undercurrent surges through the opening lines of the book of Ruth. It helps us to better understand the utter devastation of what happened next. Elimelech died. Then his sons died. In a patriarchal system that denied women inheritance rights except through the male next of kin, this series of deaths upended the lives of Naomi and her daughters-in-law. Orpah and Ruth were young enough to start over, to marry others and bear children, not Naomi. So she began the journey back to Judah, knowing she would be shamed for her family's disgraceful leave-taking. And this is where we witness the simple brilliance of the book of Ruth. As Naomi left and her daughter-in-law Ruth clung to her, proclaiming, "Where you go, I will go. Your people will be my people," we witness a woman of despised heritage change the heart of a community dead set against her. Through their own laws, this Moabite woman should be welcomed into the tribe of Israel by marriage. She married an Israelite who was now dead. She therefore should be cared for by a male next of kin from her husband's family. That law, however, ran up against a countervailing law recorded in Deuteronomy chapter 23, verse 3. No Moabite should be admitted into the assembly of the Lord, even to the 10th generation. None of their descendants shall be admitted to the assembly of the Lord because they did not meet you with food and water on your journey out of Egypt. Ruth is a flesh and blood human being caught between conflicting laws. She chose with her life to step into a hospitable reading of the law. And although the book unfolds with twists and turns, Ruth negotiated a place for herself beside Boaz, to whom she essentially proposed marriage. He accepted and did the legwork necessary to legally tie the knot. In changing hearts, Ruth moved Israel from scarcity to grace, from legalism to loving kindness, from hegemony to adoption. For her, Pedrick Otuma observes, politics, law, and religion were all carried in the body, enacted in the body, her own and the people who she adopted as her own. It is not divine intervention that saved her, but a living relationship established between two people that grew to become a transformed relationship between two nations. And so Ruth is revealed as the true wise judge. Otuma writes, "In a time of judging judges, someone has chosen to write a story where a woman's courage is the thing that returns a people to themselves, to the best of themselves." Tucked as the book of Ruth is in our canon between the abject violence of the book of Judges and the puritanical exclusion of the book of Ezra, this story also functions as a welcome critique of the God of war and empire. It lands in the heart as a lens through which the law should be interpreted. Jordan notes, "This presents us with a radical challenge, kindness and love for the other rather than ritual purity is the proper intent of the law." It should come as no surprise then that Jesus of Nazareth, of the line of King David and his father Jesse and his father Obed, traces an ancestry back to Ruth and Boaz. Her story bent the arc of the universe. Jesus is of a lineage of courage and loving kindness and grace, all because Ruth loved Naomi and refused to leave her side. "Where you go, I will go," she said, and she meant it. On All Saints Sunday, we also seek to expand our definition of family and belonging. From the moment we are baptized, we are folded into the family of Jesus Christ. And it is not simply a family of flesh and blood here, but one that transcends time and space, including that great cloud of witnesses. Like Ruth's story, how you choose to live with courage and integrity may bend the arc of our faith and our nation. How we understand ourselves, how we read our laws, how we critique the meanness of these times. A decade ago, when I was pregnant with Simon, I worked as a family support liaison at Mission Hospitals in Asheville, North Carolina. My job was to accompany families whose loved ones faced brain death after brutal injuries or tragic circumstances. Just as a family was falling apart into old grievances, just as generational family trauma and dysfunction would begin to play out, I would walk into the room and invite families to make collective, compassionate decisions about the care of their loved one. Sometimes that compassionate decision was to stop the ventilator and allow a loved one to die with dignity and return to the loving arms of God. I recall one instance when an adult child looked at me with bitterness in his eyes and said, "Why are you here? I can't stand this. It's the worst day of my life. Why would you choose a job where you walk in on the worst day of people's lives?" And so I told him, "I do it because my father was once a dying patient, and his nursing staff was so kind, it nearly broke my heart. His doctor was so wise and caring that it got me through some of the worst days of my father's life. And so I do it because I've been there. And I don't want anyone to be alone in that place. I don't want anyone to miss the face of love when the floor has dropped out from underneath their lives." You see, beloved community, First Church is our spiritual family, so we never have to face life's struggles alone. It is at once about us and bigger than any one of us. It reaches back into a storied past rooted in love and stretches forward into a future of what is yet to unfurl. It reflects God's movement, which is greater than any single expression of it. In joy and in sorrow, in conviction and uncertainty, we are held by something far greater than ourselves. A love as vast as the east is from the west, as profound as the furthest recesses of the ocean, as brilliant as the light of exploding stars, as imminent as the breath of a newborn. In season and out of season, we are held by God. Whether we feel it or can't begin to comprehend the fullness of it, we are awash in divine love. And if you have trouble today or next week remembering that eternal truth, know that you are in the right place, because here, someone else will remember for you. Someone will enfold you in mercy. Someone will guide your steps to the table of grace. We are the church, an exquisite family, an imperfect expression of God's realm. May that great cloud of witnesses surround us on every side. Amen.
As I weigh the deepest one. means we are surrounded. By such a huge cloud of witnesses, let us strip off every weight that slows down and let us run with endurance, for I am surrounded. I am surrounded. I'm surrounded. I shall.
Crosby, Stills, Nash, and Young led us in a song called Teach Your Children Well. For the offering today, I'd like us to think about how we can listen to our children well. It is a huge privilege to work in children's and youth ministry here at First Church. And one of the why it's a privilege is I just get to co-journey along. This morning, I was with five children, and we talked about the importance of self-reflection and the importance of grace when we stray from God's way. And to hear from these children who range in ages from 4 to 9, for them to pray, for them to think about the prodigal child as a real, what was really inspiring. And then I'm not going to reveal too much because I'm too excited. But next Sunday, our middle school youth are going to be leading the call to worship and the confession in words of assurance based upon a 5-week book club they've done on the book by Jacqueline Woodson called Harbor Me. What is it required of us to harbor each other? Not only the ones in our community, in our neighborhood, but the ones outside our community, the ones who are in harm's way, the ones that do not have the resources. To hear from these 5th, 6th, and 7th graders wrestle and reveal deep wells of empathy and understanding to help create beloved community is a gift. And you will be blown away when you hear their leading next week. So, for the spirit of the offering, Let us celebrate our children and youth by taking up the offering. And the easiest way to do that is to go to our website where you can pay via PayPal or Venmo. And now I invite us in one spirit to listen to the doxology.
Will you pray with me? Spirit of the living God, in whom we live and move and have our being, we give you thanks for the gift of life. From the womb of your being, you brought forth worlds. Into me, you blew the breath of life, creating humanity in your image. Even violence, sorrow, and death cannot separate us from your love, made known in Jesus Christ, who conquered death with resurrection power.
This morning, O God, we remember those from our faith community, our church family, who have died in the past year. Don Bassler, Suzanne Snyder, Pat Ashbrook, Joan King. We celebrate their lives as we continue to grieve their loss. Their memory is a blessing to each and one, every one of us. We now also want to remember the departed loved ones in our public life. And for these, we will name a few names. Richard Trumpka, Robert Bob Moses, Bunny Whaler, Cicely Tyson, Hank Aaron, Colin Powell.
We remember beloved black lives that mattered to you, O God, and to us, snuffed out by racism and violence in our city. This morning we say their names. DeAndre Johnson, Antoine Gilmore, George Watson, and the many throughout the nation whose names are less known but equally loved.
We remember more than the 745,000 Americans and over 5 million worldwide that have died due to the COVID pandemic.
Remember all of our beloved ones who have gone before us. As we light candles in memory of our own saints, and for those joining us by Zoom, we invite you to light and lift your candles as we now receive this beautiful slideshow lovingly put together by Reverend Sam. Beloved community, this is the mystery of our faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Let us now pray together the prayer of our Savior. Our God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, I now invite you to rise in body or in spirit for our closing hymn, God Be With You Till We Meet Again. Please feel free to remain standing for our choral blessing. Before that, I want to remind you to check our newsletter website and Facebook page for announcements. As a reminder, please do take a moment to sign up for the Sundays that you wish to worship in person. I understand that Diana has a brief announcement for us. She's going to use Sam's microphone.
Lift up all the people that have worked for equality of marriage. On Friday the 5th, we will be celebrating our 11th anniversary of our wedding in this community and 41 years together. So thank you for the community that you have been and for the support, because we did use the verse from Ruth, wherever you go, I shall go, wherever you live, so shall I live. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God. Mm-hmm. And that was exactly the scripture that we chose for our wedding. So I think it's very appropriate that it was today's scripture. The almighty sneaky one strikes again, as I very well know.
Thank you so much. Congratulations to the two of you on this anniversary. Oh.
It's Brendan's birthday today. We're grateful for
the
church
Brendan.
Family that has helped raise Brendan here. He turned 11.
Great. Friends, on Saturday, I want to remind you that we will celebrate the life and mourn the loss of that gentle saint of the church, Don Bassler. So please do join us in the sanctuary or by Zoom for that memorial service. I also want to remind you that this is stewardship season, and so we welcome your financial pledge. You can make that pledge either on our website or by filling out a hard copy of the pledge form that should be tucked into every single worship folder. You can place that into the offering plate on your way out if you wish, and thank you so much for your support of this community. Following worship today, those here in the sanctuary are invited to stay and greet one another, and all those on Zoom are invited to join us for a Zoom coffee hour, a time of fellowship with one another. The optional discussion question is, who are you remembering today? And now I invite our first church choir to bless us with a sung benediction, followed by the closing voluntary.
Now I walk in beauty. Beauty is before me. Beauty is behind me. Above and below. Beauty is before me. Oh.